Okay, so we've talked a fair bit in the weeds. We've talked about some of the areas of the product around policy. The next topic that might be a good one to chat about is another aspect of declarative configuration, the so-called server configuration YAML file. And I think we might split this up a little bit. So we'll start with Sanjay. Do you want to talk us through what the file is and how to go about creating one, maybe? Yeah.
So the server conf YAML is a configuration file for your integration server that has been around since version 11. Since version 12, we now have a YAML editor that we provide in the toolkit, which makes it easier to edit the file and make changes. When we start an integration server for your test server, then it will create the server conf YAML and it'll create a sparse version of that same file as well in the overrides directory as well. So that, for example, it will look for three ports for you to use for your HTTP listener or your REST admin listener or your JVM debug port.
It's kind of handy to have that template generated the first time through, whether you're doing that in the tooling or doing it using a command line version if you're running an integration server that way. So in the runtime as well, let's just sort of chat through some of those concepts.
Yeah, so I think in the runtime, I think one of the key aims when we brought in the server conf YAML file was it was a way of declaratively doing configuration so that you're not just having to run commands to configure stuff. So it makes it easier fit into containers. And so you can, have this YAML file, have this YAML configuration file in your source control as part of your pipeline. So you can say, okay, well, every time I go to a server, I fill in these certain values. And it contains all the configuration that you used to have to set up via multiple commands in previous versions. So you, as Sanjay said, you've got JVM debug ports. You've got all your other JVM properties. You've got the names of your REST admin ports, your REST admin security configuration, all the different properties you set up before, JARS URLs for connectors, all sorts of different properties that you used to have to set up by running commands that are present in these files.
So I guess for a user that's coming from one of our older versions, they'll be very familiar with running a command in order to make updates. But under the covers, of course, that command is using our admin API. So maybe we could talk a little bit about the use of the patch verb and what that
is. Yeah, so one of the things we did when we brought v11 in was we changed all our admin interfaces to be REST-based. Before, we had three or four different ways in to do admin and talk to a running server or make command changes. So everything now comes in by REST. And so this YAML configuration file is now where we store the settings. And as Sanjay mentioned earlier, we've got these overrides files. So when a change is made via a patch verb or a post verb to create configuration or change configuration, we write it into this overrides directory, these overrides properties.
So a classic way of that you might want to use this is for example, updating, changing if statistics should be enabled or disabled, or monitoring should be enabled or disabled. And we've made some really cool changes in the web UI that allows you to do this. You also have that in the toolkit as well. One thing I really like is being able to stop and start user trace and service trace for the toolkit and the web UI, because I can never remember the commands that had to be entered through the command line. But now you have a simple way of stopping and starting trace through the web UI and the toolkit. Just makes your life so much easier.
Yeah, it's kind of strange to think back to the times now, but there was a point where if you'd execute one of these commands to change monitoring or change statistics, one of these kind of variations, then the settings wouldn't be sticky if you needed to restart things, and that was always a real
not just restarting. You had to if you just did a redeploy, it'd wipe out all your monitoring and statistics settings. So if you'd spent ages setting up statistics for your flows and apps, then you go, oh, I've got a new version, redeploy it. Oh, oops, sorry, we forgot you.
And it was quite hard also to work out whether it was server level or application level and all that. Whereas through the UI, it's much easier to be able to specify, okay, I'm doing it through the application level, or I'm doing it at the flow level to stop and start statistics.
So you mentioned a few of the menus that we've got in Toolkit in the bottom left corner that enable you to make some of these changes. And in amongst that, we've also got the ability to open up a web browser interface to help out with administration. Maybe worth just saying a few things about
those
interfaces.
Not just that, so you can start a web UI to open up the web UI for administrating your integration server. But also, you can see the API docs quite easy now as well
from
an integration server. So if you want to see all the different REST APIs that are very available, then there's a simple right-click menu option on the integration server.
Sanjay's looking particularly smug because I was never sold on that idea to begin with, and now I use it literally every day of my life. So I have to eat humble pie on that one. It was a great enhancement.
Yeah, And the other thing that's worth saying there is that, you know, you've got that REST API, and you know, everything our commands can do and our web UI can do is all done by this REST API. So if you don't like our REST API, or you've got some tooling, some pipeline tooling you want to build stuff into, you can call those same REST API commands, or REST API actions, whatever, that our commands do. So you can do all your configuration externally as well, which it wasn't the case back in version 10 and earlier. Like, our commands used internal interfaces and internal communications and stuff. So now everything's public.
So having talked about the admin API as the enabler for you to make changes to your running system, that's quite a good segue, I think, to start thinking about the kind of commands that you might execute against an integration server or an integration node. And we obviously did quite a major overhaul of that in the last couple of versions. So it might be a good point to start chatting a little bit about the IBM int command. I don't know, I guess...
David,
So I think what we thought of is, you know, as stuff become more containerized and people have got better at testing, because all those great unit test enhancements in version 12, you know, we've had to start putting more effort into pipelines so that you can actually build up your integration nodes if you're using VMs and stuff, or integration servers if you're using containers. And actually, how do we take those flows and those applications from your source control, build them, and then package them up, and then deploy them out?
And it's much more intuitive to use as well, because they're verb-based. So for example, the IBM int to create something, IBM int to delete something, IBM int to deploy something. So it's very similar to the way you'd use Docker, for example, Docker commands. So it's a bit more straightforward to use, I think.
There was a lovely phrase that one of our alumni, Trevor Dolby, who worked in our department for many years, that he coined this phrase called source to server. And really, you know, all of these commands and APIs are all really about taking that the crown jewels that you've got inside source control and being able to deploy them down and get them into the runtime as easily as possible. So given that, we've got a few examples for how you might take those commands in the API. So maybe you could talk through what the ACE admin API is, and also then the ACE demo pipeline repo that's available in OT4i. But perhaps we should just start by saying what OT4i is.
So OT4i, that's the Open Technologies for Integration. So that's a GitHub repo
organization.
That we actually created several years ago now, that actually we used to push stuff out on the web, you know, demos, samples, patterns, tutorials, all that sort of stuff. We put up there, other people contribute plugins. So we used to have support pack plugins. Now those plugins and stuff go up on this OT4i repo. People can contribute, people can see what we've got there. And one of the key things we've got up there, one of the key resources we've got there at the moment, is this demo pipeline. And so that really shows you how you could put stuff into Git and then change things, run off Jenkins pipelines, run deploy scripts. And it really shows you that end-to-end scenario of going from sourcing Git to a running server. And you've got all the scripts there to do that, and there's different branches that says, oh, if you want to pull in credentials from here, use that. If you want to use the vault, or if you want to build your bars, do it this way, and if you want to do a straight source deploy, do it like this. And so maybe that building bars thing is a good offshoot to Sanjay to talk about, you know, how we used to build bar files and how we can now build bar files perhaps outside the toolkit as part of these pipelines.
Yep, so using IBM int package command, you can now build your bar file through the command line, which means that you can set up your bar file so that you can enable unit testing much more easily as well.
I think one of the big sort of bugbears that folks had years ago was that when you run the MQSI create bar command, that's actually running Eclipse, our toolkit, in headless mode under the covers. So being able to step away from that technology with some of our commands was a really important step forward.
And that headless thing was really tricky when running in containers, because I've got this container, I don't need any of all this X window stuff, all sorts of things like that. And then you go, oh, well, I'm trying to run create bar. And then because that runs Eclipse in headless modes, it still needs the X server. So you still have to have lots of extra stuff configured on your container, which you're trying to keep as slim as possible, just so you could start the toolkit in GUI, no, not quite GUI mode, to build your bar files.
I think it's, particularly if we end up with folks watching that are more familiar with our older versions, it's important to say that you can still bring all of that context with you. So if you're in possession of MRM message sets, if we wind back the clock, you can still build your dictionary files and get that to slot in with the rest of what the command does in a more modern way. So it's all still there. But yeah, hopefully as people build these pipelines now, they'll be using source files an awful lot more.
Yeah.